Church. I'm a part of this big family, and I'm going to ask that you take a pause from the COVID-19 countdown. Whatever channel you're watching that's giving you the count up of how many people have acquired it, how many lives have been lost, I want you to just pause. And I want you to just enjoy that God woke you up this morning, that we're here. Man, I've got sunlight that's creeping through just little parts. Now, that's not sunlight. That's actually a light. But I came over here with sunlight all on my face. And I'm grateful. Last May, my grandmother, Pearl Marie Scurlock, went home to be with the Lord. She said goodbye. I can't stop thinking about her peach cobbler, her rice pudding, her banana pudding, her fried chicken, baked chicken. I can't stop thinking about all the things that she left with me. And so, I'm so grateful that God gave me this breakfast of oxygen and a wonderful morning, another day of life. It's even better than all that good food my grandma made for me. So I want you to enjoy that God's got you here for a reason, and I hope you enjoy yourself spending some time with Common Ground Community Church. We're gonna have a good time. We're glad to be here, glad that God gave us breath in these lungs, and I'm glad that I get to say good morning to you. Welcome, and man, we're gonna have a good time. And now I'm going to get out your way so this service can begin.
Hallelujah. Glory by your name. Come on, put your hands together.
No! Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good, and say,
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endures forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endures forever.
Say, people from heaven,
people from heaven.
a good God. He's amazing. He's wonderful. He's everlasting to everlasting. His truth endures always. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus.
Worship gathering for you on today, for we're going to try to address some of the issues of the day. And so if you would hang on tight with us in the next 4 or 5 minutes after this time here and the Common Ground News, you will we'll move right to it, and we'll be able to reset the stage, and we'll be able to move right to it, and hopefully you'll enjoy it as well. Right now, I want to move into a time of worship and giving, and you may be saying, preacher, this is one of the most difficult times I've ever had financially. And then there are some who are giving out of their lack. And that is the one who Jesus said, she gave more than anyone else who gave. Because she gave out of her lack, and everyone else gave out of their plenty. And that's a thought. That is a thought that that continues to pervade my mind. But in light of that, I really want to thank those folks who are within our congregation who have kept giving, even despite some of the situations that I personally know about. And then those who have come from near and far. I mean, the idea is that people have dropped a few pennies in the bucket. I wouldn't say, you know what I mean by pennies, you know. Resources in the bucket. And maybe they've been blessed by this ministry as it's been online. But we want to say sincerely thank you. And so you can give by texting 31996 in the number line, 31996 in the number line to CGG. CGG, that's Common Ground Give, CGG, 31996 to CGG, and it's there. The link will come there, and you'll have the option to give online, and there's also a Cash App option for you as well. Let's pray over this, our worship and giving on today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and praise you so much for this offering. We pray, Lord, that as we give, Lord, we understand you have already given unto us. And so, Lord, help us now to be those who are not hanging on tightly, but those who are open-handed towards our neighbor. And so, Lord, even as the church, as we are, even the church is learning what it is to, what the church can do and what's possible on in days like this. And so we thank you and praise you for that as well. So we pray, Lord, over this offering that it would go for our benefit and, Lord, ultimately for your good, your glory. May you be magnified. May you be lifted up. May you be exalted, and may you be praised. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Right after this Common Ground news, we'll have our time of talking about mental health and finances.
Good morning, and welcome to your Common Ground news for April 26, 2020. Do the five. Hands, wash them often. Elbow, cough into it. Face, don't touch it. Space, keep safe distance. Home, stay if you can. Continue to practice social distancing and safety during this time. We will be having a prayer conference call from Monday to Saturday at noon. Our number one response should be prayer, and we want to pray together as a body of believers. Please dial 720-650-3030 and use conference ID code 31996 in order to join the call. If you want to leave a prayer request, you can either send it to info@cgjxn.org or call our prayer line at 601-321-9240. If you would like to give to our efforts, text the letter CGG to 31996 for our giving options, which include Cash App, the website, or the mailing address of 4203 West Capitol Street, Jackson, Mississippi, 39209. This has been your Common Ground News. Have a blessed day.
Quite often I say I have two of my favorite people here. Quite often that's my attitude and that's my disposition. But I just might have two of my favorite people with me right now. And so I'm excited to introduce them. But one of them has had a hand in raising me. And so whenever she, hits me on the hand or whatever like that, it sort of gets me in line. And that's Sister Lee Harper. And do you want to introduce yourself and tell everybody what you do?
My name is Lee Harper. I'm on the teaching team here at Common Ground. My profession is a financial advisor. And I'm glad to be here and glad to have been asked to talk a little bit about how do we handle our finances in this season. Mm-hmm.
And then we have with us, he says he doesn't like to be called Doc, but he sort of was crazy enough to go and get two PhDs. I'm using his words, not mine, but I call him Brother Brad, and he's a very great friend, and so Brother Brad Smith, and would you introduce yourself?
I just sort of want to say hello, first of all, to the Common Ground family. I miss you, and I've really enjoyed the ways that we are connecting online, and that's been really special to be able to do that. And I am the Vice President for Academic Affairs at Belhaven University, and I'm a clinical psychologist by training, and before I took up this academic role, I worked as a psychologist, seeing people every day for about 25 years. So that's my background.
All right. Well, as a psychologist, Brother Brad, I want to ask you about the stress, the anxiety of the day. COVID-19 has put forth one of the most peculiar times in history, and it will go down as one of the periods of history, like Pearl Harbor, like World War II, and others, and so the stress and the anxiety and the tension is being built up. People are at home and they don't have many releases and it's really become a difficult time. Can you talk to us a little bit about this?
First of all, let me just give a perspective in my lifetime. When Big John says that this is a stressful time, this is a peculiar time, and you can tell by my gray hair that I've seen a few times in life. And you know, I remember back in second grade when I heard the news that President Kennedy had been assassinated in 1963. And that was a stressful time as we watched that on our little black and white TVs and were wondering what was going to happen and what it all meant. And then skipping way ahead to 9/11 in 2001 in the Twin Towers. And the sense of fear and threat and the unknown. But you know, one part of 9/11 that was much different was when 9/11 happened, and those of you remember, the physical doors of the church were opened wide. There was time of prayer, there was a heightening of getting together for fellowship and prayer and learning, and that was possible. The church of the doors of the churches were open more than they had ever been before.
Mm.
And so now with COVID-19, what's particularly I think stressful for us as people of faith who love the church and who love to get together and realize that our resource comes from the Lord,
mm-hmm.
is that the physical doors of the churches are closed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an added threat and burden on how we cope with this.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that, we're looking at something, and by the way, I never dreamed in my life, I never thought about a pandemic closing the physical doors of the churches. I'm just so grateful for the gift of technology from the Lord that there are other ways that we can do things.
Mm-hmm.
But I still miss getting together in this room. But so where that has put us with this COVID-19 virus is the threats. So there is the threat of spiritual isolation, mm-hmm. for us, which makes it really hard.
Mm-hmm.
And there is the health threat of getting very sick and dying and losing those that we love through this experience. But then there is also the mental health challenge, especially for those who have had challenges before in terms of emotional problems and relational problems that go with this and being cooped up in the same room and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But then as Ms. Lee will talk about it in a little bit, there's the economic challenge. So all of these parts of this come together. And as I was preparing for this, I was thinking about the first chapter of the book of James, where James talks about that we should count it joy in times of trial, because God is using this to build to use our faith to build endurance. And so that's one part of this dynamic is building endurance or steadfastness, mm-hmm. building this sense of steadiness, of perseverance, of patience, of staying the course in our lives during this very difficult time. But then the other part, where does James go next? James goes to the idea that if you lack wisdom in this time of crisis, when things are crazy, when things are different, if you lack wisdom, what do? Wisdom is an important part of this. You ask the Lord for wisdom, and he will give it to you without judgment, without reproach. So part of the challenge of this time, particularly for those who are struggling with the emotional parts of this and the relational parts of this, is that we need faith. We need prayer. We need Bible study. We need to cling to the Lord. We need faith. Which will lead to endurance, but we also need wisdom, and we need to know the practical things to do to help us through this time. And so, you know, all truth, scientific truth, medicine, all of that is from the Lord. And so this wisdom that God gives us, some very practical things for us to think about. First of all, if you take medication, for the things that you need medication for, whether it be health problems or whether it be depression or anxiety, keep taking that medication. If you're connected with a doctor or a counselor, remain connected. And a lot of counselors are working in a telecounseling way. And if you need to connect with someone, there's a great website called mentalhealthms.com, which gives resources on how to connect with a counselor if you need that. Mm-hmm. But there's just another kind of few practical things that I want to mention as well. First of all, don't watch too much news.
Mm.
Okay? Because, first of all, things are changing, but they're not changing that fast, minute to minute, that we need to be watching the news, 24-hour news station of our choice, mm-hmm. All the time. Filling ourselves with that, rather than filling ourselves with the joy of the Lord or spending mm-hmm. our time studying the Word or connecting with people or praying. We really need to lay off the media addiction at this point, which can really get to us. Second of all, we need to take care of ourselves physically. We need to exercise. We need to think about how is this affecting my life? Am I exercising less? The university is closed where I work. There are big signs. The university is closed. Can't go there. And so I'm sitting in front of my computer most of the day having Zoom calls. That's what I do. I've had to work harder to change my lifestyle, to get my 10,000 steps and to exercise. And by the way, exercise is one of the best things that we can do for our mental health. So exercise. Nutrition is something else. How are we eating? Are we eating nutritionally? Are we taking care of ourselves? Are we doing things that relax us?
Mm-hmm.
Is another important part of this. Something else is, are we on a routine? Are we getting up in the morning, taking a shower, getting into regular clothes, keeping a sense of normalcy and routine as part of this? And something else is, are we connecting with one another? And so there's this social isolation, social distancing. Shouldn't be social distancing, it should be physical distancing as we continue to work for one another. Physical distancing, not social distancing. Mm-hmm. And a service like this is a time for us to connect socially, and that's really important. Mm-hmm. And then finally, we need God's grace in this time. Mm-hmm. We need God's grace for one another. You know, some of us have more vulnerabilities and more challenges in terms of what makes us sad, what makes us angry, our patience, what gives us anxiety. We're all built differently, and we need to be gracious one another in those times. And particularly, and I'll end with this part, we need grace in families. Mm-hmm. You know, Amy and I have needed grace with our cat, okay? Because all of a sudden there's three of us in the house all day long, and we now send our cat out. to go outside and take a break, and Amy and I need to find different parts of the house where we live sometimes, just to have a sense of connection, but also to have a sense of graciousness and peace with one another in this very difficult time.
You hit on something that I wanted to drill down right at the end, and so I want you to help me with it just a little bit more. That was good stuff, wasn't it? It was almost like he does this for a living. It was almost like, yeah, it sounded like he knew. Yeah. I need help working through my emotions. I can't pray anymore. I find it hard to pray. I find it hard to talk and to speak without outbursts, without, you know, anger, or without crying. How do I work through these emotions without running off the people in my household? It's never been like this for me before.
Because what times like this do is they amplify whatever emotions we sometimes feel, and now it's 10 times more.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the emotions that you mentioned that I want to talk about first is what I'll call the anger family of emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Anger, frustration, irritability,
mm-hmm.
all of that. And one key to that is to ask ourselves, what is really going on underneath my sense of anger? And usually it's something that's a kind of softer, more vulnerable emotion, like feeling helpless, or feeling afraid, or feeling alone. And I'll speak to the men in the church, particularly I notice men have trouble with this,
mm-hmm.
that sometimes they've got one emotional hammer in their toolbox,
mm-hmm.
and that's anger.
Mm-hmm.
But asking ourselves, first of all, what is it? What's the softer emotion, the fear, the loneliness, the helplessness? And then taking that emotion and finding a way to express it,
mm-hmm.
in a safe place. And see, our family can hear us, and family and friends and brothers and sisters in Christ can come alongside us. It's much easier to come alongside somebody that says, I'm afraid, and that's why I've been so irritable. And so to be able to express that safely, to write it down, mm-hmm. to take it to the Lord,
mm-hmm.
as the psalmist did with their lamentations.
Good.
But I think the first key is to be able to name the emotion, to increase our emotional vocabulary,
mm-hmm.
so we really can describe what's going on, to give ourselves permission to feel that in a time like
mm-hmm.
this. And to realize that God built us to be emotional people.
Yeah.
And Jesus had the whole range of emotions as well.
That's
and to accept our emotional lives as part of that, and to find ways to express it. For some people, it's artwork, it's working in the garden, it's writing it down, but finding ways to express those soft emotions.
I love that. I love what you just said there. I always think about Thomas, and how you said about Jesus, and Jesus allowed Thomas to have his emotions. And Thomas said, why can't I see them for myself? I need to see them for myself. I can't believe y'all. I need to see them. Jesus said, all right, I'll show you myself. And I think that is something that we need to understand that the Lord understands we're human, and Jesus himself became the likeness of his human flesh and dwelt here among us. That's good stuff. That's good stuff. May come back to you here as we as we drill down here. And but now I want to talk about the finances, because as brother Brad has said, hey, these emotions have come because, hey, I'm a part of the 26 million who have been who had to file for unemployment. I am a part of the 4,427,000 who had to file for unemployment this week. I'm in my mid-50s. I got started late working on my retirement. And now, what am I going to do? I lost money in this start. Am I going to have to work another 10 years? I think I'm going to have to change careers. Can I adapt now? Do I have to go back to school? What am I to do? So this the gambit runs so widely, right? So landlords are propositioning tenants for rent. If you know what I mean. And they're doing this pretty much to the most vulnerable, the African American female with children. Net worth is about $5, a little less than $5. What happens to the people who were living day to day financially before this happened?
Amen. These are hard questions. Mm. You know, they're not, it's not easy. When we talk about fears, one of the fear in that, one of the things that creates anxiety in us is when we don't feel secure. And one of the ways that we feel secure, especially, and I would say, and you probably would agree with me, Brad, is that women have a tendency to feel insecurity more than males when it comes to the lack of finances. Mm-hmm. You know, we worry about how we're gonna feed our children. We worry about whether we're gonna have a roof over our head. We worry about just a number of things. I remember when Larry and I went through 2008, which was another difficult time for a lot of people. He has his own business. His business kind of almost collapsed. He wasn't able to work. I had a business at the time. I had a restaurant at the time. And we laugh about it now, but he came, you know, he was at home one day, wasn't doing anything. I was worried about how we was gonna make the mortgage payment. And I told him, you need to get out of here and do something. Like, find something to do, because we got bills that gotta be paid, and you gotta go out there and find something to do. I was afraid. Mm-hmm. I was afraid, and basically I said, we're gonna lose everything. Mm-hmm. You know, we're gonna lose everything. That fear of insecurity that brings insecurity is the thing that challenges us most, I think, in times like these. Is what is tomorrow gonna bring when we can't see tomorrow? Mm. You know, when we look at the bills coming in when there's no finances coming in. Practically, there's some things you can do. If you have a mortgage, of course, you can call up your mortgage company and work out a deal. I promise you, they do not want your house. They want you to be able to pay for that house. They do not want a lot, and that's what happened in 2008. A lot of companies, a lot of mortgage companies actually work with their borrowers to make sure that was paid.
You know, what they will do a lot of times is they will attach it at the end of your mortgage. Mm-hmm. So you can go, and I think companies now are going up to 3 months without you having to pay the mortgage. And they're attaching that at the end of the mortgage. So even after the 3 months, you don't have to pay 3 months worth of mortgage. And so that's one of the ways that you can take care of one huge debt in your house if you own a house. The when you talk about the situation with the females that are being propositioned, they need to let somebody know that that's happening.
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
That should not be happening.
Yeah, we got to shed light.
You know, you got to shed light on darkness whenever it appears. Mm-hmm. And times like these, it will appear. Mm-hmm. You know, it will come up. And you just need to, and I know the fear for them is that, well, I'm not going to have a place to stay. You know, and that could be a challenge. I'm not going to lie. That could be a challenge of people not having a place to stay. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that we, as if you're part of a church, you need to let that body know that that's
Amen.
A struggle.
Amen.
Because that, as a family of God, we are supposed to be taking care of each other.
Amen.
And if we need to house somebody for a while until we find them somewhere to stay, that so be it. We need to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, but the one thing that I do want to talk about is not being so anxious and so worried that we miss the point of what God is trying to teach us through all of this.
Yes.
You know, Brad talked about exercising. Exercise your brain also. Think about what it is that you need to be learning through this process. The thing that I learned through 2008 is I always need to be preparing for the next one. Because if one comes, the other one, another one is going to come. And generally, this next one that comes is bigger than the one that just left. And so that's one of the things that I learned. It's like, Lee, if you don't want to be in this situation no more, how do you prepare? And a lot of that is by sacrificing today for what may happen tomorrow. That means I had to change the way that I looked at finances mm-hmm. and money. You know, it's provided so it could take care of our needs, not necessarily our wants. Not, that doesn't mean that you can't take care of your wants, but your needs need to be the thing that's taken care of first. You know, and know that something that's always coming. If it's not to you, it's somebody you know. If it's not, you know, if it's not to somebody you know, it's a family member. That's somebody that you're going to have to provide for in the future. And so preparing for that. You know, when it comes. The thing about money is that we need it in order to survive, but it's not the end of all things. Mm. You know, when I thought about, for me, I thought about a lot about, because I grew up in poverty, and if you live in Mississippi, you're more than likely, in my age, you're more than likely you did. I grew up in poverty. We planted, we grew, everything. Larry and I was talking about this the other day. Everything that we ate almost came out of a patch that we put a seed in the ground.
Talk to me.
And, you know, every piece of meat that we ate, it was a hog that we had back there in the pen. And so we got to learn how to be more innovative. Instead of fearing about what's going on, when I look at the people that's doing this protesting about, you know, I'm ready to get back to, I'm ready for life to get back the way it was, it's because you fear, you allow fear to take control of your situation. When you need to have been doing is thinking about how can I address this particular situation? God has made provision for us to do that. He's already made provision for us to do that. He made provision. He knew that this was going to come down the road, and so now we can do this thing electronically. We can still stay in touch as a church. Mm-hmm. We just can't be in the same room together as much. Mm-hmm. We can still stay in touch with family. And so he's made provision for all of that. And so looking at what those provisions that have already been made, I know how to plant. In fact, I plan to have a garden. I haven't planted in years, but I plan to have a garden.
You know, I'm
going to plant some cucumbers. The story about the cucumbers is I couldn't find a job one summer while I was in college. You know, I was out for college, and you had to, when I was coming up, you had to get a job because that was the only way you can buy clothes. you know, and prepare for your tuition for the next, you know, the next semester. So I planted a patch of cucumbers, took them to market, and that was my summer job in my mom's backyard. Mm. Took them to market, sold them, and that's how I bought clothes for my upcoming semester. And so we got to think about how to be innovative again. And maybe God is doing this so we can start doing it. Stop being so dependent on things when he has given us strength and energy and a mind to do the things that we need to do in order to survive.
Wow.
And don't let fear control that situation. Mm-hmm. Have the mind of Christ,
yeah.
Even in the midst of a pandemic,
yeah.
And maybe even more so.
That's good. He didn't give us the spirit of fear. Okay, so your president and mine, Donald J. Trump, sent out checks, and he made sure he had his name on them, and so he sent out checks of $1,200 to people. Most people have received theirs. Some people still have not. Okay, so what do you suggest to those people who are working, who receive those checks? And then what do you suggest to the people who are not working, who are receiving those checks?
Good question. My husband, again, got very angry about the checks. He, not so much for the people who needed it, but there were people who didn't need it that got those checks. Folks that are still working, making $70,000, $80,000, $100,000 a year, got $1,200 when there's people that could barely eat, you know, that got them. So his thing was, is that why don't we take care of the folks that really need it? And then, you know, those of us that don't need it as much, you know, we could have done it differently. When you do get the check, I would pray that the first thing that you do with it is to take care of, again, your needs. The fact that you need to pay your rent, the fact that you need to pay your mortgage, you need to pay utility bills. Let that be the primary, what that's going to, especially for those of us that may not have an income, a steady income that's still coming in. For those of you that got it and didn't need it, I would hope that you would talk with people that maybe that you know that needs some additional help and see if it's the way that you can help them out. And then also provide a savings for that, because again, this is here now, but something else is always on its way. And so just being a good steward of that you have been blessed with, ask God exactly what he wants you, what's the best way for you to use those resources, you know. And some of us I hadn't gotten one, so I'm still hoping for one.
She hadn't got her.
I hadn't gotten it. In case anybody have anything to do with it, I still hadn't gotten mine.
President Trump, she has not gotten...
In case he's watching, I haven't gotten my check yet.
Department of Treasury, she has not gotten her
Would
check.
Love to get one.
Yes.
So, yeah, just be mindful to be a good steward of whatever resources you have, you know, and make sure that we're using it in the right way. And don't forget the church. You know,
amen.
We do want to tie it off that $1,200. We don't want to forget the house of worship when we're talking about that.
Brother Brad, is there anything that you have to say in regards to my mental health and stability as it relates to finances as we close?
Yeah, just as we close, I think a couple things. First of all, one emotion that we haven't talked about specifically here, but I think is a really important one, is the one of shame.
Mm.
And embarrassment,
mm-hmm.
of losing one's job,
yes.
of not being able to pay the bills. And so this is one that we really need to realize that there is nothing to be ashamed of, because what shame does is it disconnects us from people, and it keeps us from reaching out to our landlord and saying, hey, or our bank or whoever it is, and saying, hey, I want to talk to you, because what these folks are looking for is people that will communicate with them. So this emotion of shame, I think, is really important. The other thing I just want to swing back on is this idea of faith developing endurance. Because even though I'm hopeful that things are not going to be like this forever, there are some things, and I think we know this as a church, that are going to be changed by mm-hmm. this. Mm-hmm. And they're already talking about another wave of this. So the idea of learning all we can, building our faith and learning all we can through this experience is really important.
That's good. That's good. Well, there's so much, and there's so much more that we can continue to talk about. If you all want to ask more questions of Sister Lee and Brother Brad, how can they contact you?
My email address is leeharper@me.com. Ooh, I can't believe I said that. But yes, please. I know a little bit about finances. I'm not the know-it-all, but I do know a little bit and can help you a little bit. But yes, you're welcome to contact me by email, leeharper@me.com.
And I'm B.M. Smith at Belhaven, BELHAVEN.edu, and welcome your emails.
You see, they didn't say you can hit me on Twitter, IG, or anything like that. But that's okay. We'll help them out here soon. No, I'm teasing. I'm teasing. But I just want to sincerely thank you all for accepting this invitation, and helping us move the ball forward as it relates to these very important issues. These are very significant issues in very unstable times, and times that, like I said, we've never seen before. And so we want to be sure that we are addressing them in the way that is godly, and in the way that is taking the right approach. And we know that we are all struggling with something, you know, and dealing with something. Me, myself, you know, depression has been one of the issues that I've had to deal with when the lights go down, and when the phone calls stop and everything goes out and I'm left alone with my thoughts. I had to battle with depression and loss, and after losing a loved one, and so just processing all of that, just processing things. I think it's important that we think about these things, talk about these things, and that we don't hide them, and that we don't sweep them away as if it's not real. All right? And so as we move forward, we do want to thank them for their time. Please, please, please email them and let them know your questions, and let's also encourage them as they continue to do great and wonderful work within our community here in Jackson, Mississippi, and nationally. Thank you. a